बुद्धं शरणं गच्छामि धम्मं शरणं गच्छामि. ऑन द डे ऑफ वैशाख पूर्णिमा वॉज बॉर्न अ रेवल्यूशनरी कॉल्ड गौतम बुद्ध, द फाउंडर ऑफ बुद्धिज्म. द हिस्टोरिसिटी ऑफ हिज बर्थ प्लेस एंड टाइम आर डिबेटेबल अमंग द स्कॉलर्स. एज पर द बुद्धिस्ट ट्रेडिशन ही वॉज बॉर्न इन लुम्बिनी इन नेपाल एंड ही वॉज रेज्ड इन द कपिलवास्तु which was the capital of the clan of Shakya. Shakya were a tribe of rice farmers that dwelt at the border of modern-day India and Nepal. The Buddhist sources also state that Buddha was born in a Kshatriya family named Gotama. His father was Suddhodana and his mother was Maya.
Suddhodana, who was Buddha's father, did not want his son to become a saint. He wanted him to become a great ruler of the kingdom and carry on his legacy. Suddhodana made every effort to conceal the young Siddhartha from the outside world. Siddhartha was raised in prosperity and wealth, so he was naturally oblivious to the pain and suffering of the outside world. Nevertheless, Siddhartha was always cogitating about the purpose of things and the connectivity of nature. He was oblivious to the concept of death, pain, disease, and suffering. Gautama grew up in princely luxury, shielded from the outside world, entertained by the dancing girls, instructed by Brahmins, and trained in archery, swordsmanship, wrestling, swimming, and running. When he came of age, he married Yashodhara, who gave birth to a son named Rahula. He had, as we might say today, everything. However, this wasn't enough.
While riding a chariot on the streets of Kapilavastu, he encountered three simple things: a sick man, an old man, and a corpse being carried to the burning grounds. Nothing in his life of ease had prepared him for this experience, and when his charioteer told him that all beings are subject to sickness, old age, and death, he could not rest. As he returned to the palace, he passed a wandering ascetic, walking peacefully along the road, wearing the robe and carrying the single bowl of a sadhu. That was when Siddhartha resolved to leave his life for a higher purpose of finding the answer to the problem of suffering. He bade his wife and his child a silent farewell without waking them, and then he rode to the edge of the forest where he cut his long hair with his sword and exchanged his fine clothes for the simple robes of an ascetic.
With these actions, Siddhartha Gautama joined a whole class of men who had dropped out of Indian society to find liberation. There were a variety of methods about teachers, and Gautama investigated many atheists, materialists, idealists, and priests. He finally settled down to work with two teachers. From Aradha Kalama, who had 300 disciples, he learned how to discipline his mind and to enter the sphere of nothingness. But even though Aradha Kalama asked him to remain and teach as an equal, he recognized that this was not liberation and he left. Next, Siddhartha learned how to enter the concentration of mind, which is neither consciousness nor unconsciousness, from Udraka Ramaputra. But neither was this liberation, and Siddhartha left his second teacher as well. For 6 years, Siddhartha, along with 5 companions, practiced austerities and concentration. He drove himself mercilessly, eating only a single grain of rice a day, pitting against the body. He was emaciated and he seemed more dead than alive.
Siddhartha realized that liberation could not be achieved by enduring pain. Then Siddhartha entered a village in search of food. There, a woman named Sujata offered him a dish of milk and a separate vessel of honey. His strength returned. Siddhartha washed himself in the Nairanjan river and then set off to the Bodhi tree. He spread a mat of kusha grass underneath, crossed his legs and sat. He sat having listened to all the teachers, studied all the sacred texts and tried all the methods. Now there was nothing to rely on, no one to turn to, nowhere to go. He sat solid and unmoving and determined as a mountain, until finally, after 6 days, his eye opened on the rising morning star, so it is said, and he realized that what he had been looking for had never been lost, neither to him nor to anyone else. Therefore, there was nothing to attain and no longer any struggle to attain it. So it was that Siddhartha Gautama woke up at the age of 35 and became the Buddha, the awakened one, known as Shakyamuni, the sage of Shakya.
The first noble truth of Buddha stated that all of life, all of existence is characterized by dukkha. Even moments of happiness have a way of turning into pain when we hold on to them. Or once they have passed into memory, they twist the present and the mind makes an inevitable, hopeless attempt to recreate the past. Dukkha is noble and it is true. It is a foundation, a stepping stone to be comprehended fully, not to be escaped from or explained. The experience of dukkha, of the working of one's mind, leads to the second noble truth, which is the origin of suffering, traditionally described as craving or thirsting for pleasure, but also and more fundamentally, a thirst for continued existence as well as non-existence. Examination of the nature of this thirst leads to the heart of the second noble truth, the idea of the self or I, with all its desires, hopes, and fears, and it is only when this self is comprehended and seen to be insubstantial that the third noble truth, the cessation of suffering, is realized.
Finally, in the fourth noble truth, he revealed the eightfold path or the Ashtanga Marga. The five ascetics who listened to the Buddha's first discourse in Sarnath became the nucleus of a community, a Sangha who followed Buddha's ways. For the next 49 years, Shakyamuni walked through the villages and towns of India, speaking in the vernacular, using common figures of speech that everyone could understand. He taught a villager to practice mindfulness while drawing water from a well. And when a distraught mother asked him to heal the dead child she carried in her arms, he did not perform a miracle, but instead instructed her to bring him a mustard seed from a house where no one had ever died. She returned from a search without the seed, but with the knowledge that death is universal and inevitable.
Gautama Buddha passed away in the town of Kushinagara at the age of 80. Some of the assembled monks were despondent, but Buddha reminded them that everything is impermanent and advised them to take refuge in themselves and the teaching. He asked for questions one last time and then left his body. Buddha lived a life of an ascetic. He lived the life of a prince, a life in the search for truth about human suffering. He was the one who gave a simple path towards enlightenment and bliss with a simple teaching of compassion and the pursuit of truth. Today, Buddhism has 470 million followers worldwide, and it is considered as one of the most peaceful religions. Who would have known that Buddha's teachings would later inspire Emperor Ashoka, who was one of the greatest kings that India has ever known? As rightly said by Buddha, we live in an illusion and the appearance of things. There is a reality. We are that reality. When you understand this, you see that you are nothing. And being nothing, you are everything. Shubhaste Panthanas Santu, Jai Hind, Jai Bharat.